In sex education, both the teenagers and the adults who are supposed to be guiding them feel intense shame around sex. Between raging hormones, repression, and resentment, shame creates fierce conflict for the characters. My name's Natasha Preskey, and I'm a freelance journalist who writes about sex and relationships and social issues affecting young people. First, let's talk about shame at Mordell, because as we see at the beginning of season two, it can be contagious.
What is going on?
Chlamydia, everyone's got it. One for a fiver, three for ten.
The season opens with the school in the grips of an STI outbreak.
It's a plague!
Don't let them breathe on you.
But when we see one student ostracised by her friends for allegedly being patient zero, it's clear that the epidemic isn't really about chlamydia.
Gwen and Martha think I've only given them chlamydia, girls, but she's clear. So we check all the boys that they slept with, and they're clear too. Look.
Why is there no one's name on here? Gwen and Martha have been sleeping with them for ages.
It was me who gave my friend Gwen chlamydia.
Why didn't you tell them?
Why didn't you tell them?
They're already ashamed of sleeping with me.
For Owen, having an STI isn't just an inconvenience. It's another sign that he's embarrassing and unworthy.
Imagine if they knew I had an STI too.
His silence allows the infection and the shame that comes with it to spread throughout the school. By identifying the source of the outbreak, Otis is briefly able to quell the students' hysteria. But the shame which infects the characters isn't so easy to silence. And often, those characters can only really work through their shame via someone else. And most of them use one of two very different mediators, Otis and his underground teenage sex clinic, or in season two, his mother Jean, a qualified sex therapist. Let's start with Otis. While inexperienced, he has a talent for encouraging others to open up about their problems.
Sounds to me like you're experiencing some performance anxiety.
He's an approachable sounding board, despite his inexperience, because he's non-threatening. Otis may be a virgin. His tips may be a mixture of overheard wisdom from Jean, common sense, and, in one case, porn.
This is research!
But his non-judgmental demeanour enables him to genuinely help others. But when it comes to his own feelings, Otis is just as knotted up as his classmates. Unable to masturbate, and only willing to confide in Eric, Otis lives in opposition to the messages of openness he evangelises to his clients. Even his advice is relegated to the darkness and secrecy of an abandoned toilet block. Despite the fact they run a sex clinic together, Otis is, for most of series 1 and 2, completely unable to tell Maeve how he feels about her.
What?
And when it comes to girlfriend Ola, it's clear he's an inexperienced teen, just like his clients. Otis finds himself yet again falling back on the theory, but this time it lets him down.
You're bad at fingering.
When he's drunk, Otis's openness goes from 0 to 100, and he alienates both Maeve and Ola.
I like Maeve. I like Maeve a lot. Like, a lot more than I liked Ola.
Afterwards, he drunkenly sleeps with Ruby.
Did we have sex?
Of course we had sex, Otis. I'm not here because I enjoy your company.
The fallout from his one-night stand briefly forces him out of his role as self-styled sexpert and makes him face the scary world of sex and relationships head-on as a fumbling teen.
It's his penis. He's paying for it.
Later, he and Ruby share a tender moment as platonic friends, each having had their vulnerabilities exposed and survived. In season two, the person Otis gets all his tips from comes into Mordell as an advisor. When Jean starts helping out with sex education at Mordell, suddenly students are able to get their advice for free in a well-lit classroom from someone who not only has years of experience as a therapist, but also, crucially, has actually had sex.
Sex doesn't make us whole. And so, how could you ever be broken?
Jean is knowing and unshockable, and doesn't recoil at the students' confessions and worries. Unlike Mordell's teachers, she's impossible to embarrass. In fact, she has so little shame that she doesn't even realise that her curiosity makes Otis feel scrutinised in his personal life.
I've noticed you're pretending to masturbate, and I was wondering if you wanted to talk about it.
In direct conflict with Jean and Otis's openness is Headmaster Mr. Groff, who's a stifling force on both the student body and his own family. Jean's presence is a constant source of discomfort and frustration to the buttoned-up teacher.
Our curriculum is quite satisfactory.
He's so ashamed that he may have caused his marriage breakdown that he lashes out by scattering the therapist's private notes, Regina George style, across campus. No one experiences reflected shame from Mr. Groff as severely as his son, Adam. Struggling to understand and accept his sexuality, Adam reacts with the anger and hostility he has been shown by his father.
Look, I hate you.
He in turn projects his own feelings of shame onto Eric, visiting him only under cover of darkness following their confusing sexual encounter at the end of the previous term. By contrast, new kid Raheem proudly pursues Eric and wants nothing more than to declare their relationship to the world.
Honestly, you smashed it, Raheem. What? You just kissed me.
Yes, Eric, if you're gay, I did.
Where Raheem accompanies Eric to the arcade, Adam takes him to the tip, his secret nighttime hangout where he vents by smashing up old junk. It's in this dark yard of rust, china and glass that Adam later helps others channel their feelings in the same way.
Do you want to go and smash some shit?
Yeah, all right.
Meanwhile, Amy's story is one which shows how to tackle shame as she struggles to come to terms with being sexually assaulted on her way to school. Her peers at Mordell don't initially see the effect this has had on her, but we do. As time goes on, she becomes afraid to take the bus and doesn't want to be intimate with her boyfriend.
Do you not want me to?
What makes you think I don't?
Having initially dismissed the assault as nothing when talking to Maeve, she's later too ashamed to tell anyone the impact it's having on her. This shame eventually turns to anger, and it isn't until a group detention that she's able to open up about the effects of her trauma.
You're fighting over a stupid boy!
Ames, why are you crying?
Because I can't get on the bus.
Despite the personal differences between the group and the different cliques they inhabit, they're suddenly united by their anger at this universal experience. All the girls have, in one way or another, been affected by the shame that can come with receiving unwanted attention from men.
What binds you together?
Other than non-consensual penises, miss, not much.
When Ola leads the group to the junkyard, we see a rising crescendo of female anger, entirely free of shame, as the group sets upon a car with mallets.
I'm angry that a horrible man ruined my best jeans and nobody did anything, and now I can't get on the fucking bus!
As season two draws to a close, the students perform their school play, Romeo and Juliet reimagined in a sex-positive cyberspace.
Mr. Hendrix, what the hell is going on?
Artistic expression, Mr. Groff.
This sets the stage for the characters to rid themselves of their shame, braving disapproval from Mr. Groff and embarrassment in front of their peers.
I want to hold your hand. Please?
By confessing his feelings in the most public way possible and making himself vulnerable to humiliation, Adam proves that he has defeated his shame, at least for now. He is at last more afraid of losing Eric than of being open about his sexuality. It is then Otis's turn to be humble, having been laid bare as the pretender that he deep down always knew himself to be.
She wasn't giving out sex advice. I was, and I shouldn't have been, because I'm 16 years old and, well, I've only had sex once. My mum is an excellent therapist, and she cares about people.
The show quickly descends into an outpouring of shamelessness. After Adam's confession of love and Otis's confession of guilt, the students brazenly shout out the once embarrassing sexual problems Jean has helped them to overcome, no longer embarrassed.
She reassured me that my labia is a normal length.
She really helped me accept myself. It's changed my life.
I fucked some warm fruit, and she said I wasn't weird.
Mr. Groff, outraged by the students' display and by the play's sexual content, loses his power as censor and enforcer of shame. The room is abuzz with excitement, warmth, and acceptance, and at last, the students seem unafraid. We're reminded that working through embarrassment is a normal part of adolescence and needs to be tackled head on. In all, sex education is a manifesto for openness, compassion, and acceptance. The show takes the messages of fear-mongering, abstinence-based sex ed and turns them on their head. It rewards its characters for allowing themselves to be vulnerable and for refusing to be ashamed.